could stand and worship the Lord today. I wandered so aimless, my life filled with sin. Oh, I wouldn't let my dear Savior in. Then Jesus came like a stranger. Oh, praise the Lord.
Would you bow your heads and go to the Lord in prayer with me? Lord Jesus, we're so grateful and thankful we can come to this place, gather in your name today, and worship you. Father, we thank you for your mercy, for your watch care over us, for your love and your guidance, and most of all, Lord, your grace. Lord, we pray today that as we lift our voices in worship to you, that your Holy Spirit, that he will come down and fill this place. And Father, as we pray every Sunday, we come in agreement, standing upon the authority of your word, and we ask that if there be any man, woman, boy, or girl on this church campus that does not have a personal relationship with Jesus, that today will be the day, Lord, that your Holy Spirit will convict them of their sins and convince them of their need of Jesus. Father, we love you again. We thank you again, and we need you. In Jesus' name, and everyone said, amen. Let me welcome you again. You may be seated. Let me welcome you again before Sherry comes to give us some announcements. And if you're visiting with us today, we're glad that you are here. You came on the last Sunday of the month, and the last Sunday of the month around here is when we do old hymn singing songs. So you're going to get to hear a lot of old hymns this morning. If that's not your cup of tea, come back next week, and we won't be doing old hymn singing. We do that the last Sunday of the month around here. Sherry, if you'll come and give us some announcements.
Good morning, everybody. I am not Aaron and Becca this morning, but I'm going to fill in for them. Could pray for Aaron and Becca. Aaron woke up with a fever this morning. They are school teachers, so there is no telling what they caught in the first couple of weeks back to school. We want to welcome all of our guests this morning. If you are a guest, know that if you have any questions, you can reach out to the following folks. If these folks will just stand up, raise your hand so people know who you are. Jan Gruber, back here in the back. Michael McNary is walking around back here. And Mike Blackburn, right up here. So if you have any questions, you are a visitor, come find one of those folks or any of our folks up here on the stage. They can answer any questions for you. Let's see. We have, if you are a guest, we are happy that you're here to visit with us today. If you are one of our regular attendees, just know that you can drop your tithing in the wood boxes back here in the back. We've got two in the back here and one over here to drop that tithing in. Or you can donate, or you can do your tithe online at Cornerstone Church Lucas-online giving. Sunday evenings, we have another service here at the church at 6 o'clock. Randy Fletcher will be bringing tonight's message from the book of 1 Peter 3, entitled Christ's Suffering for Us. So that will be an awesome lesson for us tonight. And be in prayer for Brother Randy as he brings that message to us. We also have worship, Bible study, games, snacks, and crafts Sunday evening for our children ages 2 years old to fifth grade. So if you want to come on Sunday evening to hear Brother Randy give us that message, we do have a children's program for those children fifth grade. Wednesday nights, 6 o'clock, we also have our potluck dinner before our Wednesday service. Come, everyone is welcome. Please join in bringing food. We have fun and fellowship, followed by the midweek service by Randy or Michael. Sunday morning, we have our Sunday school classes that start at 9:15. We have women's and men's classes. We have co-ed classes, nursery for children's ages newborn to 4. And then we have children's classes for kindergarten through 5th grade and youth, which is 6 through 12. So be in prayer for those kids and those teachers. And we do have those available for anyone visiting or regular attendees. Starting September 10th, Sunday, September 10th at 9 a.m., the Seeking Heart Sunday School class is starting a new study. It is a 9-week class, so if you are interested in joining that class for 9 weeks, they are doing a wonderful study called Respectable Sins by Jerry Bridges. It is about the sins that we have come to think of as everyday life and how to overcome the everyday sins. They meet in the last classroom down here on the right. If you are interested in knowing more about this study, or if you would like to join that study for the next 9 weeks, starting September 10th, it is during Sunday school, 9 a.m., see Debbie Ocker or myself. We can get you the information or get you a book. So please let us know if you're interested in that class. Worship and services start at 10:30 on Sunday mornings. We want to ask that parents help us, and please speak to your children. Let them know that drinks and food are not allowed in the playground or in the sanctuary. And also, for safety reasons, we have to keep the kiddos out of the inside of the coffee bar. So if they are 12 and younger, we need to make sure they're not behind the coffee bar counter. So if you could please help us with that as well. We still have opportunities to serve here in our church. Across the board, we need some additional helpers, fill-ins, as well as we have one spot open to work with in the nursery with the kids during Sunday morning service. So if God has laid that on your heart to help with the kids, whether on a regular basis or just a fill-in if someone is out sick, please let myself or Diane Seaton know. We still have some prayer pencils back there, guys. Most of our current kids here at the church have already been chosen, but these prayer pencils include kids that were here for VBS. This includes kids that may have not been here for many years, but all of our kids still need prayer. This is a crazy time in life that we live in, and these kids have such a hard time at school. So please, if God is laying this on your heart, please grab a couple of prayer pencils out there. Even if you don't know these kids, prayer is the best medicine for all of these kids. So please make sure you grab those. Fall Festival, October 29th. We still need volunteers to help with the different booths, passing out candy, ministering to these kids. We also need some financial donations as well as candy donations. So be thinking about that. Halloween candy has already been out in the stores, so those can be collected at any time. Kiki, are you doing that? See Kiki if you have any information on that. Homeless Ministry is still collecting items through the end of this month, or I'm sorry, September, through the end of September. So bring those. You can drop them off in the youth room. If you bring donations throughout the week, make sure you place that in the youth room. And that way we'll have that for the fall festival, or I'm sorry, the Homeless Ministry. The church is planning a trip to the Holy Land. April 19th through 29th, please see Beverly Johnson. Is she here today? Did I see Beverly? No. Okay. See her or, I don't know, who else is in charge of that? Holy Ministry, or the Holy Land? Beverly. Just see Beverly. Okay. and then if you have any announcements that need to be added for this run through of all the announcements, make sure to get those to the church office by Wednesday for the upcoming service. And before we continue our worship, we're going to go ahead and stand up and greet our neighbors and let them know you're glad they came.
Amen.
Thank you, guys.
redeemed. How I love to proclaim it, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, redeemed through His infinite mercy, His child and forever I am. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed.
It's my favorite hymn. I love that hymn. Apart from the Lord, we are nothing. Apart from the Lord, we can achieve nothing. Apart from the Lord, there is no salvation. For salvation is found in one place and one place only, and His name is Jesus.
Amen.
And we have been pardoned for one reason only, and that is because He shed His blood, so that through the shedding of His blood,
there is coming a day.
Amen.
When no heartache shall come. Oh, no more clouds up in the sky. And no more tears will dim the eye. For all is peace forevermore on that happy golden.
Stay.
be seated. Brother Derek Draper is going to come deliver God's word to us again today. Would you welcome Brother Draper back to us? Amen.
Good morning. How's everybody this morning? All right. Well, I watch MeTV quite a bit. Anybody else? Andy Griffith Show. Usually watch that quite a bit. I was reading the other day about Raymond Burr. Okay. Anybody know who Raymond Burr is? Perry Mason. I read the other day he had a brother who was a timberjack, a lumberjack. His name was Tim Burr. So I'm just playing. That was a bad joke. Sorry, that was a bad dad joke. So, I grew up in Wiley, many of you know, and some of you have been around these parts for a while. Some of you may even journeyed into the Wiley supermarket back in the day. The Tibbles were the owners of the Wiley supermarket. They lived three houses down from where I lived. And their daughter, Sheila, met and dated a man by the name of Neil. Neil played at Baylor. He was the quarterback of the 1974 Southwest Conference champions, the Baylor Bears. And he also went on to play in the NFL, went to the Chargers and Giants and Oilers. And some of you don't know who the Oilers are. Ask somebody. It's the team before the Titans. So, But Neil, when he would come home with Sheila, he would play football with us. And he would get out there and play with all these little kids and just, you know, throw that ball. Of course, I don't think he took anything off of it because it would hurt when you would catch the ball. And Neil really is the one who got me interested in Baylor. And from that point on, because Neil took an interest in me and he would spend time with me when he would come home, I loved Baylor. And I would go to Baylor games. Some of you remember RA days down at Baylor. I would go to RA days. And my sister, when she was in college, I would go and watch the games. And I remember the first time that I had suited up at Baylor. I was able to put on the jersey and everything and the helmet. And we just the first time running out of that tunnel at Floyd Casey Stadium. That's the old Floyd Casey Stadium. Now it's just ground. It's nothing is there. But I just remember running out of there and just, from all the years of watching the games there and the opportunity to experience that atmosphere on my own. And so it was a neat experience. It was a great experience. It was an awesome experience to get to do that. This morning we're going to look at a man who had a way better awesome experience when he encountered God. We're going to be in Isaiah chapter 6. We're going to really look at the whole passage there. And as you turn there or you open your page or you turn on your device, I'm going to ask you to stand in honor of God's word as we read. If you're able to, we're going to read God's word, Isaiah chapter 6. It says, "In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne high and lifted up. And the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him stood seraphim. Each had six wings. With two he covered his face, and with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one called to another, saying, 'Holy, holy, holy is the Lord, the God of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory.' And the foundations of the threshold shook at the voice of him who called, and the house was filled with smoke. And I said, 'Woe is me, for I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts.' Then one of the seraphim flew to me, having in his hand a burning coal that he had taken with his tongs from the altar. And he touched my mouth, and he said, 'Behold, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away, and your sin atoned for.' And I heard the voice of the Lord saying, 'Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?' Then I said, 'Here am I, send me.' And he said, 'Go and say to this people, keep on hearing, but do not understand. Keep on seeing, but do not perceive. Make the heart of this people dull and the ears heavy, and blind their eyes, lest they see with their eyes, hear with their ears, and understand with their hearts, and turn and be healed. Then I said, how long, O Lord? And he said, until cities lay waste without inhabitants and houses without people, and the land is desolate waste. And the Lord removes people far away, and the forsaken places are many in the midst of the land. And though a tenth remain in it, it will be burned again, and like a terebinth or an oak whose stump remains when it is felled. The holy seed is its stump. Please join with me as we pray. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that it's truth to us. Father, I pray today that you would honor your word today. Father, that we would hear from you. God, that we would hear your Holy Spirit speak to our hearts and our minds. And Father, may we respond to you today because of who you are. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. And all God's children said, amen. Amen. You may be seated. In this passage, you have King Uzziah. He reigned from around 783 to 742 BC. And Judah experienced a stable government under Uzziah. And after his death, it marked a change in the political and also the social scene. His predecessor, he was succeeded by Ahaz. Ahaz was free to implement anything that he wanted to do. And Ahaz chose entrusting in Assyria's protection instead of relying upon God's protection. And that did not settle well with Isaiah. And this passage right here, we see that Isaiah accepted really an impossible assignment from God. And as we look in the first four verses of this chapter, we see some of the characteristics of God. Isaiah stepped into the presence of Yahweh God. It is thought that Isaiah was part and played a part in the temple because he knew of the different things that were involved in the temple worship. He saw the Lord seated on his throne. He saw the train of the robe fill the temple. He saw the Lord and he felt the presence of the Lord. It says the threshold shook, and he also saw the angelic beings who were around God declaring the holiness of God, and he smelled the aroma of smoke, and he felt the coal upon his lips, and he experienced God with all of his senses. And Isaiah experienced some of the very characteristics who are at the heart of who God is. This morning we're going to look at the characteristics that he experienced, the characteristics of God. The first was the majesty of God, and then the holiness of God, and also the glory of God. And so in the first two verses, we see the majesty of God. We see the majesty of God, and he experienced this. And majesty, we don't use that word a lot today, but it means to honor. It means beauty. It means to be esteemed, or it means excellence. It's giving reverence and respect. And so we see right here the angels, the seraphs, were giving respect to God in his court. The seraphs, along with the cherubims, were the chief angels of God. And the seraphs were known as the fire spirits. They were honoring God by flying around, declaring his holiness. And we find a lot of different passages throughout Scripture about the majesty of God. And I included some of those right here. Psalm 96, 6 says, splendor and majesty are before him. Strength and glory are in his sanctuary. And in Psalm 93, 1, it says, the Lord reigns. He is robed in majesty. And then it says, the Lord is robed with majesty and is armed with strength. And then in Psalm 104, 1, it says, praise the Lord, O my soul. And it says, O Lord my God, you are very great. You are clothed with splendor and majesty. And then 1 Chronicles 29 says, yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the majesty and the splendor. And then he says, for everything in heaven and earth is yours. So Isaiah described one of the characteristics of God here, his majesty. So why is that important for us today? Why is it important for us? There's a guy that by the name of Louis Giglio. Some of you may have heard him speak or read some of his books. He had Choice Ministries down in Waco when I was in school. He had Choice Bible Study. But he also has Passion. Some of you may have heard about the Passion Conferences. He's the pastor at Passion Church out in Atlanta, Georgia. But he says this. He gave a definition of worship. He said that worship is our response to God for, says, both personal and corporate, for who He is and what He has done, expressed in and by the things that we say and the way that we live. He's also really boiled it down to this. Worship is our response to what we value the most. It's our response to what we value the most. I lived out in Justin for many years, out by the goat out there in Argyle. I was out there when they built the Texas Motor Speedway. And after that, I saw some great worship take place, okay? About the week before NASCAR would come in April, there would be people that would come up and sit in the parking lot, set up their campers, and they would set up camp there for a week out. They would get their flags and raise their number. Any NASCAR fans in here? Maybe, but they would raise their flag. They would stay there the whole week, and then on that Saturday and Sunday, they would pack the stadium. That was worship. Those people valued the racers, their car, whoever their driver was. They worshiped that. And so that was a great picture of worship. And the question is, how much do you value God? How much do you value God? You know, one way we worship is through declaration. And just as the seraphs did, it says that they declared who God was. And our lips need to esteem God by words and through song. Worship is not limited to Sunday at 10:30 or Sunday night or whenever people gather for so-called worship. Worship is a way of life. We not only worship through what we say and what we sing, but it is also the way that we live. And so we see right here, our life is a response to the majesty of God. And so Isaiah not only looked and saw the characteristics of the majesty of God, but he also saw the holiness of God is the second right there, the holiness of God. And these angels of fire, the seraphs, proclaimed the holiness of God. The angels were protecting the way to Jehovah God. They were declaring what many have been thought to have been the liturgical worship in the Jerusalem temple. And the holiness of God is described in three ways. First, the holiness of God is total and absolute in His essence. There is no compromise to His holiness. Second, His holiness is transcendent over all creation. And then third, holiness is pure. There is no sin in God. He cannot tolerate sin. And that is why we are separated from God, because of our sin, because of Adam, because of that first sin. We are separated from God. We cannot be in God's presence. And the only way that mankind, that you and I can be in God's presence is through the cleansing. And we'll see this. We'll talk about that in just a little bit. The seraph statement is not an isolated statement in Scripture. If we look at the end, I have this, and we see John in Revelation. He writes this, and it says, and around the throne and on each side of the throne are four living creatures full of eyes in front and behind. The first living creature like a lion, the second living creature like an ox, the third living creature with the face of a man, and the fourth living creature like an eagle in flight. And the four living creatures, each of them with six wings, are full of eyes all around and within. And day and night, they never cease to say, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." It says, whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to Him who is seated on the throne, who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before Him who is seated on the throne and worship Him who lives forever and ever. They cast their crowns before the throne, saying, "Worthy are You, O Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for You created all things, and by Your will they existed and were created." So what is the importance of the holiness of God? Why are we looking at the holiness of God? Because the holiness of God provides a standard for you and for me. You know, I don't know if you know what a standard is. A standard is something like this, okay? We have We have a measurement. This is a little tape measure here. And so it shows us how much an inch is and how much a foot is. And so this is a standard. You know, instead of going and say, hey, Michael, how much is a foot? If he goes like this, you know, we have a standard to measure. Okay, Michael, you're a little off here, but this is a standard. And I think a lot of times we have standards around us that we look at. There are other standards in the world. For instance, basketball. The standard for basketball is who? Michael Jordan. All right. The standard for football is the 1972 Miami Dolphins, the undefeated team. I think, there we go, Miami Dolphins. We have one for real estate. Who's the standard for real estate? All right. We have standard for real estate. And then business. We have, this guy right there. We've got also for family. We see this. I know that was the standard there. But motherhood. We have somebody for motherhood. Yeah, Miss Cleaver. And then just for hospitality, we have the hospitality. And then also for friendships. There we go, friendships. So that's a good one. So, but as we look right here, holiness is the standard for you and for me. It's a standard for everything. Holiness is the standard for our work. It's the standard for our relationships. It's a standard for our families. It's a standard for our marriage. It's a standard for school. Wherever you are, that is the standard, is holiness. And the standard is for us to have those pure motives to work and not cheat and not lie and not be deceitful. We are to forgive. That is the standard which he's talking about here, the holiness of God. Isaiah realized this. He realized that he was sinful and he could not even speak in the presence of God. And Isaiah encountered the majesty of God. He encountered the holiness of God. And he also came face to face with the glory of God. And you see right there, that's the third thing, the glory of God in verse 3. And the glory of God is closely connected with the holiness of God, as we see here. It is the external manifestation of the divine essence of God. The whole earth is filled with the glory of God, which literally means it's heavy with God, or it's awesome. And Isaiah not only saw the robe fill the temple, but he also heard the glory of God filling the earth. And the glory of God can also be seen in other areas of Scripture. And what you see right there in John 1:14, it says, "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen His glory, the glory as the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth." And we also know that God is everywhere. Psalm 139:7 says, "Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence?" No matter where you and I go, God is there. You know, universally, people can discover how awesome God is through His Son, Jesus. You know, God has not changed in 3,000 years. Hebrews 13:8 says that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. God is still majestic. God is still holy. The whole earth is still full of God's glory. So how do we experience these characteristics of God? You know, chances are that none of us in here have had an experience like Isaiah did. But we can experience and encounter God like Isaiah did for those who have placed their faith and trust in Jesus. You know, there are some basic ways that you and I can have that experience. The first is get in God's Word. Just get in God's Word. We read about who God is through His Word. A lot of people say, you know what, I experience God. I have all these experiences with God. But those experiences are good, but they need to be filtered through the Word of God. So God shows Himself to us through His Word. And you've got to get God's Word yourself. You know, it would be awkward, and I know I've said this before, it'd be awkward for us to see a capable adult be fed by somebody, right? And that's the same thing. We've got to get God's word for ourselves. There are a lot of ways that we can get God's word into our mind and into our hearts through reading his word, through different apps. There is no, we have no excuse because we have ample resources to get God's word into our mind. And second way is we got to spend time in prayer. Spend time in prayer. I know those are basic things, but when we pray, it makes us sensitive to the Holy Spirit and to his calling upon our lives. And it allows us to see where God is moving. And when we're praying, we get to see and experience and feel where God is moving and join him in that work. And then third, we've got to recognize God's work in our life. And God has revealed himself to you in many ways, even today. Maybe this week, he has been something in your life. Maybe he's been your provider this week. Maybe he has shown yourself to you as your healer. Maybe he's been your protector. Maybe he's been your strength. I don't know how God has shown himself to you this week, but we've got to reflect on how God has shown himself to us. God reveals his characteristics to us in many ways, and we've got to open our eyes and see how God is showing himself to us, because God is always working. Isaiah saw the magnificent characteristics of God. He saw the majesty of God. He saw the holiness of God. He saw the glory of God. And after he saw these things, Isaiah responded. And we see that in verses 5 through 13, Isaiah's response. And earlier we said that worship is our response to God. Worship is a response to what we value. Isaiah responded with confession to his sinfulness. His lips were considered to be the seat of depravity. And Isaiah declared that he was finished or doomed because of his sins. And he was conscious of the sins of the tongue. And Isaiah knew that he was sinful before a holy God. And so the first way that we must respond to God and to who he is first we have to be cleansed. We have to be cleansed. And we see this in verses 5 through 7. And after Isaiah's confession of his unholiness, one of the angels of fire came to cleanse him with an act of purification. And Isaiah was familiar with this ritual cleansing with fire. The coal symbolized the temple ritual and cleansing. There are a couple of scriptures you may want to write down, Deuteronomy 4:24 and Isaiah 33:14. Both of those state that God is a consuming fire, and it's a fire of righteousness. Isaiah's cleansing came through confession. And the same is true for you and for me today. We are cleansed through confession and repentance. Romans 10, 9 and 10 says, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with the heart one believes and is justified, and it is with the mouth one confesses and is saved. And there are many passages in Acts. As you read through the book of Acts, you probably have seen this. It says, repent and turn to God so that your sins will be wiped out. 1 John 1:9 also tells us this. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And then James 5:16 says, therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person has great power and is working. And just as Isaiah did, we have to confess our sin and turn and repent and turn back to following God. When we do this, the Bible says God will cleanse us from all of our unrighteousness. He will make things right so that we can be in the presence of God. And so we see right there, we must be cleansed. The second thing right there in verse 8, we must answer. We must answer. Isaiah had a choice to follow God. And his call was not unlike that of Moses. Moses really didn't have a choice right there. But God's question to Isaiah required a personal response. It also required a willingness on Isaiah's part to be obedient. And you and I, we have a choice to answer God's calling just as Isaiah did. And our calling in Matthew chapter 28, it's right there on your page, Matthew 28, 18 through 20, it says, all authority, this is Jesus talking, all authority in heaven on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. And the question is, have you responded to God's call that He's placed on your life? He's called you to go. Some of you have answered God's call and saying no. And you, instead of saying, here am I, send me. Again, you may have also said, hey, God, just wait. You know, one thing is we talk about in our house and is delayed obedience is disobedience, right? And so we sometimes tell God to wait. God tells us to do this, and we say, hey, just wait, God. And you may have been a Christian for years, but you have not responded to the great news, the great commission that God has given us. And God has called you to go across the street, and He's called you to go to talk to your neighbors and to be a faithful witness to your family and to your friends and those co-workers that you have. And God wants you to answer just like Isaiah did, here am I, send me. You remember Ananias in Acts chapter 9. That's the same way when God called Ananias to go to talk to Saul. He said, here am I. You know, that was the thing. He responded the same way, here am I. And that needs to be your response. That needs to be my response to God today is, here am I. When He calls us to go, here am I. You know, He may send you, like I said, He may send you across the street. He may send you around the world. He may send you some prisons, right? He may send you to go those places that people may seem, places that people don't want to go. And so He may send you wherever, but He calls each one of us to be that faithful witness where we are. No matter in our schools, our neighborhoods, at our work, He calls us to be a faithful minister there. Many years ago, there was a song out by Mercy Me. Some of you may have heard of Mercy Me. They're from over in Greenville. But they wrote a song. It's called Here Am I. And here's some of the lyrics of the song. It says, on the other side of the world, she stands on the ocean shore, gazing at the heavens. She wonders, is there something more? Never been told the name of Jesus. She turns and walks away. What a shame. Just across the street is your hometown, leaving from his 9 to 5, gazing down the road, he wonders, is this all there is to life? Never been told the name of Jesus. He continues on his way. What a shame. Whom shall I send, and who will go for me to the ends of the earth? Who will rise up for the King? Here am I, send me. And then it says, whether foreign land or neighbors, everyone's the same, searching for the answers that lie within your name. I want to proclaim the name of Jesus in all I do and say unashamed. And that's what God's desire for us is saying, God, here am I. Here am I, send me. When He calls you to do something, is we've got to answer, here am I, send me. The third way that we must respond is that we must persevere. We must persevere. That's verses 9 through 13. And the commissioning of Isaiah doesn't end right here in verse 8. You know, there's more on this chapter. And this part of the commissioning is not appealing. God gave Isaiah what seemed to be an impossible assignment. It was the hardening of Israel. God wanted to show salvation was only found in Him. The old nature had to be totally destroyed before God could bring new life from the ruins. And God's forgiveness came through death. And the allusion that is made here is in reference to the invasion by Sennacherib or Nebuchadnezzar. The holy seed were the survivors left in the land after the invasion. And the message God gave Isaiah were hard words of judgment. You know, this message did not make Isaiah a popular person, and nor did it make Isaiah happy. He preached the harsh message because of his deep conviction of that commission, of him saying, here am I. And when many people answer God's commission, and you know, sometimes we expect great results. We expect us to be the next Billy Graham or whatever that may be. But that simply may not be the case. We want those easy assignments and people quickly to respond. And it, God may have worked like that in your life. But there may be some of you here who have prayed and shared Christ with someone for many years, and they have not come to know Christ. But, you know, we've got to continue to be faithful and let God worry about the results. We've got to be faithful in sharing. Galatians 6:9 says, "Let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we'll reap a harvest if we do not give up." There's a movie some of you may have seen. It came out many years ago. It's called The End of the Spear. And it's the true story of the five missionaries who were killed down in Ecuador to the Aka Indians in 1956. And after they were killed, 2 years later, the sister of one of the missionaries who were killed and the wife of one of the missionaries who were killed, they went and they lived among the Aka Indians and shared the Christ with them. And that's what this movie is about. And what a difficult calling they had to go live among the people who killed their brother, who killed their spouse. And they lived among them and shared Christ with them. And they became, they follow Christ and they responded to Him. And it may not be living among people who may have killed your family, but it could be when you answer the call, you could get ousted by your family. It could cost you your family. It could cost you your job if you stand up for Christ at your job. It could cost you that. It could cost you monetarily. It could send you to go to talk with an unfavorable person, somebody that you may not like, and could be a neighbor. It could be some unlovable people at your work or even at your school. But the question is, will you persevere like Isaiah? Will you be faithful through those difficult times? And when you get a glimpse of who God is, there will be a response. And when you encounter the majesty, when you encounter the holiness, when you encounter the glory of God, will you fall down? Will you worship Him? I want you to think about your last week. You know, how has God shown Himself to you this past week? I know we talked a little bit about that a while ago, but I want you to think about something and write that down on your sheet there. How has God shown Himself to you this past week? Maybe, like I said, He's been your provider. Maybe He's been your healer. Maybe He's been your peace this week, or your life, or your rock, or your wisdom, or your love, or your banner, or your truth. I don't know what He's been to you this week, but I want you to think about that and write that down real quick. And if you have that, what we're going to do is we are going to say a phrase together. We're going to say, "God, thank you for being," and then you're going to fill in that blank. There's going to be a lot of different responses that are coming at God, but I think He can handle those, right? And so just a time to thank God for who He is. So does everybody have sort of what they're going to do? All right, here we go. The phrase is, "God, thank you for being," and you may say, "my friend," or, "God, thank you for being my rock." I don't know what that may be, but it's what God has been in your life this week. Are we ready? Here we go. Let's say this all together. "God, thank you for being my peace." And when you see the holiness of God, will you confess your sinfulness and will you be faithful to the task that God has given you? You know, God desires to accomplish His purposes through you and through me. And how will you respond to God today? I don't know if some of you may be in here and have not received Christ as your Lord and Savior. You know, the Bible tells us that, as we said a while ago, because of our sin, we are separated from God. But the good news is that God made a way that you can have that relationship with Him. And the Bible says that the wage of that sin is death. Because of our sin, we deserve eternal damnation. We deserve that separation from God eternally. But the good news is that there is a gift that God has given you, and that's Jesus. And He wants you to receive that gift of eternal life and that salvation. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And the Bible says that we have to admit to God that we're a sinner. We believe that Jesus is God's Son. We confess that He is Lord. And if you're in here and you've never received that gift, I encourage you to do that today. And some of you here maybe have that relationship. You say, hey, I need to get things right with God. I've been going in this direction. I need to turn back to following Him and get back and repent and turn from Him. And some of you may have been avoiding that call that God has been placed on your life, avoiding the call to make that call to your neighbor or, talking with somebody about the Lord. But I don't know how you need to respond to Him today, but I know that when you and I encounter God through His Word, we need to respond. But I'm going to ask you to stand with me as we give this time to the Lord on this invitation here. However you need to respond, I want to encourage you to do that. There'll be people up here who will pray for you. But if you would like to ask Christ into your life, it's a prayer. And so if you would like to do that, if you want to pray this prayer after me, I'm just going to ask everybody to bow your head. And you can say this prayer. Dear God, I know that I am a sinner and my sins have separated me from You. I want to receive Jesus into my life to be the Lord and Savior of my life. I confess those to You today and repent and turn to You. I want You to be Lord and Savior of my life. And if you prayed that prayer, I encourage you to talk with somebody up here. If you need prayer, if you need any type of prayer, I know people are in different God has put you in different positions. God has brought you through different experiences. And I don't know what your need is today, but if you need to have somebody pray with you, I'm up here, these other people up here. If you just want prayer, you can come up. But however God has shown Himself to you today, we've got to respond. And let's do that now.
How I love to proclaim it, redeemed.